Drake season is here, and we got Mark from Spectrum Pulse to talk to us about it.
Hey there, folks. I'm Mark from Spectrum Pulse, and yeah, Drake album bomb. It's here, and this is Billboard Breakdown.
Remember.
Look, I know y'all don't want to hear me complain again about Drake. I'd be well within my rights having to cover 13 new songs from this project a week after I actually fully reviewed it. And by all means, the discourse has kind of moved on. It's a chore more than anything else. And Drake's cultural ubiquity stopped being interesting years ago. But I will say that there were some expectations that this was going to do a little better on the Hot 100 or last a little bit longer. And with a new Bad Bunny project coming next week, it's gonna be fascinating to observe the upcoming fall off. But yeah, let's start in the top 10, where Drake, of course, got the new number one, almost entirely driven on streaming, but good sales came to nudge this over the top. First person shooter with J. Cole. Now, I don't expect it's gonna last at this height, and that's tied to our number two.
Yeah,
I don't
give the a Yeet fuck song Drake is gonna Yeet, take over
where
this
the Yeet
one.
Fans here are trying
it
to
already has.
Concerted streaming push to keep this in the top 10 to be at least competitive next week, though they didn't even win the streaming battle here. Speaking of which, Virginia Beach by Drake got the number three predominant.
Best song on the album, by the way, Virginia Beach, fucking fire.
On streaming, and then we got the first non-Drake entry with Paint the Town Red by Doja Cat at number four, mostly because of consistent radio growth and how its YouTube is a lot better than you might expect. Then we got two more Drake songs, Calling for You with 21 Savage at number five, and
Calling for You. Shitty shit song, bro. It would have been way better. Okay, look, that Calling for You would have been legendary if first they take the fucking, I don't even like saying, the fucking bitch in the middle of the fucking song. Why is there just a woman complaining for a minute? Drake was in the studio. He listened to this entire fucking song and listened to this woman. No. Like, you have to get this through your head. Listen to this woman complain in the middle of the song for like a minute and a half. Was like, yeah, that's fire. We should release that. What the fuck are we doing, Drake? Look, man, look. If Drake, like, oh my god, that song. Bro, that song is such a waste of potential, bro. Imagine 21 on the first beat. The first beat is fucking fire. Drake kind of went off on that beat, too. But, look, 21 Savage verse. The only reason it didn't really stick out was because of the beat he was on, honestly. Like, the beat he was on is just like a regular-ass beat. The first beat was fucking fire. First, take the woman out of the song. Why is she there? Second, just make this 2 minute. It could be a 2 minute 30 song, literally on the one beat with Drake and 21 Savage just spitting bars. That's all it could have been, and we all would have been happy.
Slime You Out by SZA returning up to number six, both thanks to a lot of streaming. And then Snooze by SZA held up to number seven, which I'll chalk up to a thin sliver of radio dominance. And the reason for that, once we get past Daylight by Drake at number eight, again streaming, is Cruel
Don't talk
Summer
to
by
my
Taylor
man
Swift,
like
number
that.
Nine. Where there's been a real concerted
I like
and
it.
Sales
and you
push,
like it.
And you could tell that her fans are desperately trying to make this a thing to challenge for the number one, at least before
I think it will, actually.
Taylor's version drops.
Because she just discounted
finally,
it and another
Drake
EP
song,
for it.
Fear of Heights at number
not
10.
Another, just EP for
you
it.
All get the drill by this point. So let's move on to our losers and dropouts. There literally were no returns, and the only gain was Slime You Out getting into the top 10. So we're going to drill in a little bit of the songs that have been forced off. We got the tracks that clinched their year-endless spots like Karma by Taylor Swift and Ice Spice, and Calm Down by Rima and Selena Gomez.
Obviously.
All the way from the top 10 into recurrence with
Damn.
Where She Goes by Bad Bunny, likely winding up getting there, but it's borderline. I've said that before. But then we get a swath of songs that fell very well short. Oh You Went by Young Thug and Drake, Sabor Frieza by Fuerza Regida, Tulum by Peza Pluma and Montera, In Your Love by Tyler Childers, Spotless by Zach Bryan featuring and Fiend by Travis Scott and Boy Cardi. But now for all those losers, it's literally 64 songs. It makes rattling them off utterly.
Come on, man, Sam, what the hell, dude?
Album bombs.
That's your fucking job. Come on, man.
Weeks at least. So Let's focus on the tracks that didn't lose by that much, like Fast Car by Luke Combs clinging onto radio momentum at 13, or okay. I Remember Everything by Zach Bryan and Casey Musgraves still having a lot of tangible streaming at 14. It did not get undercut by the album bomb by that much. Then we got the songs that actually held their own, and the majority are of legit quality. My Love, Mine All Mine by Mitski held at 54, pretty much to my astonishment. It appears her virality's got staying power.
No, it actually is, though. Wait, let me check Spotify, bro. That shit's actually going insane. Wait. I'm pretty sure it's, like, top 5 right now, isn't it? Like, top 50 US. It's number 3? Bro, what? God damn, Mitski, okay. Number 3, top 50 US, okay, okay.
And off the debut, Water by
Tyler. Not sure if it's gonna get radio play. Could he get radio play? I think it could get some, maybe. Probably.
Stick Season by Noah Kahan. Imagine how big these could have gotten without Drake squatting over here.
That's what I'm saying,
bro. Those holding firm are all that good, because the last two are Can't Have Mine by Dylan Scott at 90, and God Gave Me a Girl by Russell Dickerson on the debut to 96, both of which I'm chalking up to Nashville radio inertia, and how Drake's album predominantly hit the upper half of the Hot 100 with more tangible impact. Speaking of which, we are absolutely in an album bomb scenario,
obviously.
And the bigger one, with a full 22 new songs. The majority are in the top 20, and I'm going to be talking about them. But outside of those, and accounting for the best and worst this week, we got Tried Our Best at 21, Members Only with Party Next Door at 24, although this was very close to being among the worst. It's bad. All the Parties at 26 featuring Chief Keef, Drew Picasso at 27, Another Late Night at 29 featuring Lil Yachty,
Wake
From Home at 32, BBL Love Interlude at 36, Polar Opposites at 37, and Screw the World Interlude at 42. Now again, this still gives us, frankly,
what song didn't make it?
Arrivals.
Oh, it's 22 because Slam You Out's already on.
Number 97, Why Loro by Junior H.
Fuck is this? This is not Drake.
You know, there was so much discourse about another song potentially breaking through this week, that Ecstasy by Suicidal Idol, and it being one of the worst many have heard in recent memory. And instead, we got a solo Junior H regional Mexican
track, I gotta listen to that.
Zero discourse altogether. And when you hear this,
and obviously, because it's Drake's week, buddy. Exactly, who does this guy think he is? Going on Billboard when it's Drake's week. Come on, man.
Skitter of percussion. The production all sounds undercooked. And when translated, the lyrics are a lot of post-breakup misery. Albeit with
this guy just has the same script for every regional music, regional Mexican music song.
Desperately escape how bad
production undercooked.
What's coming to the realization?
Post-breakup song, the same fucking thing every single time.
The song could sell that melancholy whatsoever. As it is, it's more forgettable than bad, far from the best or worst in the subgenre, just not much else to it. Number 76, She Calls Me Back by Noah Kahan and Casey Musgraves.
I was not baptized. Everything's alright when she calls me back. She calls me back.
Okay.
All right, I've been hyping up this remix for the past couple of weeks.
I've never heard of this.
Best songs on the original Stick Season, augmented by Casey Musgraves stepping in.
Oh fuck! Should I just listen to Noah Kahan?
Binging sessions. Cause let's be real. Even if I do like
the I don't feel like listening to the pattern of the original song, this is a bushy song to go off on why this girl has been going crazy recently.
Calling him back and accusing her of having some sense of stubborn pride when she's going out and chasing her own dreams, even as he tries to save her. Now, the benefit of bringing in Casey Musgraves is that she can push back on all that projection, and the frustrated exhaustion that she can sell to temper all the mood is a huge benefit, especially as she's still calling this guy once a week to soothe his feelings. Apparently that's not enough. It reminds me a lot of Somebody That I Used to Know by Gotye and Kimbra, but unfortunately I'm thinking that Noah Kahan is left off the hook a little bit more here, especially given all the acoustic swell on that chorus. So while I will say it's a very big improvement on the original, again, songs like this can test my patience, and I think Noah Kahan is pushing it, even if I think it's really damn good, if not great. All I'm saying.
Watch me best of the week.
Wild Ones by Jesse Murph and Jelly Roll.
You are not Flo Rida.
It's get out of here. It's interesting just how much it feels like certain folks have turned on Jessie Murph as a pop country act. I don't think the organic groundswell is really there, but she sure as hell is getting the collabs and folks outside of her core fandom who either don't like her or aggressively don't care about her. Now, granted, okay, when the songs keep being this bad, I get why. With its lead-in, scratchy trap beat with the fake snaps and the clunky attempt at country twang, and a vocal mix that seems to be trying to make this sound way edgier than it actually is. And while Jessie Murph is doing her whole disaffected BB Rexha impression, that's bad enough. Who the hell told Jelly Roll that bringing back his rapping was a good idea for this verse? And then there's all the posturing that they're into all sorts of wild, dangerous vibes like smoking and drinking hard liquor and even holding a gun, and then referencing Harley Quinn in Gotham City, where Jelly Roll saying the police will never take them alive. I'm sorry, it's just hysterical how much I do not buy this. What it reminds me most of is Bad Things by Camila Cabello and Machine Gun Kelly, where the collab has no real chemistry.
Guys, I have a confession to make. I still listen to that song. Look, shoot me now. You can shoot me now. It's okay. You shoot me with your fucking shotgun, okay? I like that song. I literally have it on my playlist. I have a hundred song playlist that's literally on that, and I listen to it from time and time again, just like on the shuffle of the playlist. Look, I don't know. I like the song. I don't know. I don't think it's that bad. I don't think it's that bad.
It doesn't make a lot of sense, and yet it thinks it's got way more swagger and bite than it does. But at least Bad Things have the fastball sample to make it somewhat interesting.
Honestly,
this
yeah.
This just actively sucks. Next. Number 20, Bahamas Promises by Drake.
Sad that I know the it's crazy, bro. I think I listened to this album like twice. I still can't really remember. Like, the only songs I remember, like, the sound of Virginia Beach, because Virginia Beach is the only one like I actually like listen to like almost every day. I don't give a fuck. First Person Shooter. Rich Baby Daddy, very memorable. Slime You Out. Maybe Another Late Night. And Daylight, only because of Don't Talk to My Man Like That. You know what I'm saying? So, oh wait, yeah, I think that's all of them. Oh, Amen. And pretty sure that, yeah, that's it, man. I only remember 8 songs out of 23. Is that good? I don't know if that's good. That's already an F, man. Come on, Drake, that's an F. Broken pinky promises. Like, I don't remember what this is. Like, what is this? Know that you're not for me.
Okay, a lot of Drake songs to get through here. I've already reviewed the album. I'm gonna try to keep this short for each track, if only for my own sanity. And we're gonna start off with a glorified interlude that actually did have some promise, with its gentle R&B warbles and the richer backing vocals from Jeronel, until you recognize that the content is Drake crooning about how his shot with this girl named Haley, who was reportedly a young model that worked on one of his album merch rollouts, I think it was for Certified Lover Boy. And well, how all that blew up in his face, because she apparently screwed up a trip to the Bahamas for him and broke some promises, so now he's in full concern trolling mode, where even if he says he's got too much respect for himself, well, you know that's bullshit, because otherwise this track would not be here. Next. Number 18, What Would Pluto Do by Drake. Working on her, I'm not finished. Last time
I saw her, she was fucking with my nigga, so the question is, I thought Future was gonna be on this one. I was hoping it was gonna be like a secret Future verse on it. I don't know.
Drake, if you're taking romantic advice from Future, it's probably a bad idea, especially if it results in you dosing this girl's drink with Cialis.
How are we gonna name this song What Would Pluto Do and not even have Future on it, bro? Like, bro, you literally call Future on, like, I know this dude, I don't know, I don't know fucking Drake, but I know that Drake can just, bro, Future, send me a fucking verse. Future, send him, like, a little 20, 35 second bars on the song. Boom. Done. Like, that easy. I already know he could do that.
Without a condom.
But no Future Verse, really, man?
Needs a sister. If only that was the only thing about this what? Song that I doesn't work. I actually kind of like that muted piano line, but then Drake's doing his swamped out half crazy tune where the Lil Yachty influence is both unmistakable and unwelcome. And then Drake goes off on his flexing bullshit where he spends most of his final verse recognizing that this girl did not get a breast reduction to then get inside and bend a dick like the Pope. And that's not the only painfully corny line at the end of that verse.
That's a bar, man. Come on, what are you talking about?
An actual Future collab could have saved this song. Oh my god. Pray for the remix? Number 17, 8 a.m. in Charlotte.
If he's smart, he'll do a remix.
Top from a bitch that work at corporate sales. Chinchilla, you shock, we skiing out at Courchevel. Breaking news, they try to kill him, but the boy prevails.
He'll probably right, like this one.
A Drake song I actually like on this album that unfortunately got mired in controversy thanks to the Conductor Williams credit and the Chipmunk Soul sample. A lot of folks were assuming that Drake was biting Griselda style. I got mixed opinions on that. I mean, Griselda did not originate that sound, especially in the underground. Drake has always done his extended timestamp songs over vibes that are very similar to this. And I'm not about to complain about Drake actually rapping a lot more. And it turns out this is one of the better songs on the album. I'll say it again. Now, it is not exceptional. I don't want to overstate this. Drake running through money and flexes and a lot of veiled threats at his ops. It's routine at this point. But the wordplay feels a little bit sharper, and I do like him trying to give some advice to those who are up and coming in his way to cover their own taxes, and how he actually holds some information against his enemies. I mean, it's implied to be Pusha T, but I'll believe that when he actually fires a real shot. So yeah, most of this is kind of petty. But it actually
bro, imagine being Drake's son. Shit, bro. Like, if I was Drake's son, like, if I, like he probably plays Roblox, bro. This kid probably has, like, 3 billion Robux in his fucking account, bro. Like, he's, like, rich as fuck.
Feels more grounded. And if I think more of the album was like this, it'd have a better reputation. Decent song. Number 16,
probably, yeah.
7969 Santa by Drake.
Bro. This song could have been so good, bro. Okay, I do remember. I kind of remember this one. I only remember this one for the really shitty, like, vocal. It's not vocals. It's, like, flow or, like, just, like, sound in his voice. This is just fucking talking on the track.
I just wanna get you off of my mind.
Like, what the fuck is that? Not shit. That's what it is. But then Tizo Touchdown just goes fucking bonkers at the end of the song, and then Snoop Dogg just starts talking. I'm like, what is happening?
I just wanna get you off of my mind. Hey, yeah, damn.
Why does this also feel like a fragment or an interlude? Is the painfully on-the-nose Snoop Dogg cameo, the Tizo Touchdown part, or the Chief Keef sample, or the brittle windswept production?
Oh yeah, I forgot about that. The Chief Keef sample.
A more impressive hook, but then Drake sounds half asleep as he complains about that, some girl.
Yeah, it sounds the line, just half
got asleep. You out here moving waist like a belt. Overall, just feels tossed off, not particularly interesting. If not for the perfunctory shoutouts and Snoop Dogg, I'd call it filler. Number 15, Amen by Drake.
I like
the,
this one isn't
Touchdown.
Bad. It's okay.
Speaking of Tizo, okay, I know I'm not the only one who's not hearing the hype with this guy. I know he's getting the
what?
Big industry.
Those vocals are awesome, bro.
I know his album from earlier this year got some pretty divisive reviews, but this is probably his biggest cosign, and hell, he's got more space to deliver all the gospel flourishes against those twinkling staccato piano chords and the soul sample and the leaden bass than Drake does for his verse. But honestly, it's not a bad verse, as it does connect through all the things that he's buying this girl to.
It's an alright song. That's alright.
Loyalty that he probably won't reciprocate.
Fuck, this album should have been so much better, bro. Oh my god.
Framing this track as
like, I'm a Drake D writer, number
man.
One D writer. Like,
well
I can't even
he does.
Like, defend a lot of these
even
songs.
He's probably gonna cheat on her.
Well, I mean, I can. I can, but like, the thing is, like, a lot of these songs are just mid. Like, at the end of the day, you know what I'm saying? Like, I thought this album would like. Like, it was like rumors, like, oh, guys, old Drake's back, that type of stuff. But no, it's just the same fucking thing that he does all the fucking time. Fucking just slow ass shit, like extended fucking run times. Also, another thing about Drake, Why are all these songs like 4 minutes and 30 seconds or 5 minutes plus? Why is Rich Baby Daddy 5 minutes? Can someone tell me that? That song needs to be 3 minutes maximum. Look, here's what I would do. If I, from an artist standpoint, if I want to make Rich Baby Daddy a fucking smash hit, which it definitely could be, take out Sexy Red's verse. Pretty much useless. Take out the outro. Literally, that song is like 3 minutes. Look, just have Sexy Red on the chorus, and then Drake and SZA verse, and then just that's it. That would be a club banger. But no, now all the people who are playing this at the club, they gotta take out the fucking outro because no one's gonna dance to that shit. Like, come on, Drake. Like I'm not. Why does he do this shit, bro? Like, he just makes songs like longer than they have to be. It's just so fucking annoying, bro. Song on the album,
and it does nothing for any sense of broader momentum. But outside of Tizo Touchdown being generally fine, this isn't special. I'll say it. Number 12, Gently by Drake featuring Bad Bunny.
This song is shit. Bring it to Ibiza. Introduce you to Richie Akiva. My broski banito, he needs a banita. Africa, bien loquita.
Gracie po mi amor, mi amiga. Ella sabe que está bien rica. I think this was the song that turned off a lot of rap fans expecting more, well, rap on this album. I don't get why, as Drake and Bad Bunny have worked together going back to at least 2018. Maybe folks just didn't like the obvious
play of the commercial cross. I thought this would be so much better than it actually is. Because I think it's like 2 minutes. It's like a 2 minute song, basically. I was expecting like some Mia vibes, bro. Mia, like, I don't even think I've listened to Mia like all the way through, but like, I can already like I can already remember it as like, it's like a pretty like memorable song. Like the chorus is pretty memorable, you know. Drake on it is pretty memorable. Like, that, I feel like that was a way better song than this. Like this is what I feel like. I think Drake was the feature on that song, and like, you could definitely tell that it was Bad Bunny's song. But like, when you give like the power to Drake, this is what he fucking gives you. He gives you fucking shit. And it's just so disappointing.
Drake's cringeworthy Spanish is about as bad as, well, mine is. But once you get past Drake, the bassy reggaeton groove actually has more texture and punch than I expected. And it gets better when Bad Bunny comes in for...
Yeah, honestly, yeah.
...the Latin trap for his very horny brand of debauchery. It's probably lacking more melody to really stick for me.
It's
in my
too
case,
short. Like, I'm not gonna call why are you making the songs that don't need to be 5 minutes, 5 minutes, and then you're making the songs that need to be longer, fucking 2 minutes. What are we doing, man?
It is a commercial cash, and let's be real. But I also don't think it's bad, all things considered. And hell, if you want real cash in, number 11, Rich Baby Daddy by Drake featuring Sexy Red and SZA.
Look. This is a very mixed song. Mostly more bad reviews than good. Look. As I said before, this song could have been, like, I'm too young to go to the club. Like, I know club shit when I hear club shit. And I know, like, everyone would go crazy, like, just at the club, like, listening to this shit. But, like, it's just, like, why is there an outro to the song, man? Like, just make the fucking outro into, like, an interlude, bro. I don't give a fuck. Make the fucking album 24 tracks. I don't care. Why is this song 5 minutes, bro? Like, just dragging shit for no fucking reason. It actually makes me mad. And this beat is so good, too.
I remember seeing so many people getting so mad about this song and Drake working with Sexy Red for the cheapest strip club pop I've heard in a while with that bounce groove. But again, I'm not surprised that Drake is doing this. He's done it for years in various capacities. And for what it's worth, it's not a precisely bad crossover either.
I don't think
Sexy Red needed a verse, but her hook is...
What did I fucking say? I literally said... Just keep her on the chorus, take away the outro, the song would be good. Like, three minutes and 30 seconds song. Like,
more on point than...
Like, oh, Drake just, like, does these decisions I just don't get. Like, I don't get it.
Expected. The washed out melody bounces out the quicker percussion pretty well, even if the vocals all feel really compressed on this song. It's one of the few tracks on this album with actual momentum, I'll give him that. And while Drake can sell a lot of his day's strip club musings, SZA once again steals the show. She sounds great opposite this production. But the big problem is one that's endemic across this album, and we're gonna get to more later, and that before the song properly ends, Drake tacks on this outro where he seems to come to his senses and realizes he probably should not have made all those promises in the strip club, but also interpolates Dog Days Are Over by Florence and the Machine rather badly. Now, I don't mind the idea of what Drake is trying here, and that he's trying to be regretful of all this, but it also pushes the track for 5 minutes, and it feels like this fragment was stapled on in post.
Yes! That is what I'm saying. Why is the outro here? Why, man? I'm not. I don't even make music, and I can know like when a song is like a hit or not. You know, like Drake just does these like stupid fucking decisions that I just don't get. Like, why is a song 5 minutes? Like, you already know. Like, you already know after fucking Sexy Red is done singing and it starts going into the fucking vibey outro, like, the DJs are skipping that shit. There was no reason of putting that shitty fucking outro at the end of the song and just ruining the entire song entirely. Like, it's just fucking shit, bro.
Execution's just really haphazard. Yes. So, no, I don't hate this nearly as much as seemingly everyone else does. I just can't say it works exactly well either. All I'm saying. Number 10, Fear of Heights by Drake.
What is this one? Oh, this?
Okay, dude, you gotta stop concern trolling Rihanna. It's gone so far beyond creepy at this point. I mean, the watery synths might try to set off a conspiratorial vibe and leave it quasi-ambiguous, but then we get the grinding rage beat with the wispy trap snares as Drake goes off on more generic flexing, and now he totally does not pay for sex. He's just tipping for the service. Sure, dude. And I get how Drake is trying to accentuate how scary all this is, as if his bad Playboy Cardi impression doesn't already spook you. But truth be told, I'm not scared. Not by any of this. There should be something tangibly unknown that might drive some fear, and all this is just way too goddamn familiar. So yeah, next. Number 8, Daylight by Drake.
Bro, what is this? What is this? This is not the song that I listen to. Where's the Adonis? Where's the Adonis?
Okay, let's put aside the painfully obvious Tony Montana snippet from Scarface to open up the track. I know Drake's playing the villain. The grimy trap beat from Southside, it's obviously setting it up. But I will say it, it's a bit more effective in selling the atmosphere, and while Drake is still on his very bad Playboy Cardi imitation, the wordplay is a little punchier across the threats on the second verse, even if I'm not about to engage with how this
what second verse is this is Adonis' song. What are we talking about?
Rumors around his death. But again, Drake just does not have the intensity or tangible menace to sell this well, and I'm left thinking that more folks are probably here for Adonis's clumsy but kind of endearing outro than anything Drake is actually saying here. And you know, while we're in that territory, number 5, Calling For You by Drake featuring 21 Savage.
Bro, this, bro, oh my god, like I'm just hearing the fucking first beat again. This shit is so fire. She know I'm coming steady. She wanna hold a gun. If you want it, you can have it. Oh my, bro, like I'm just imagining like, fuck, I'm just imagining like, oh my god, I'm just imagining like just taking the fucking bitch off. Like off the song in the middle of the song and keeping 21 Savage on the same fucking beat. Oh my god, bro. This song has been so legendary. Oh my god.
Let's be real. The only reason that this is charting this high is because the folks who liked Her Loss are praying that it's a leftover. And it is, in many of the worst ways possible. The one thing I'll somewhat endorse is the blocky Jersey club rumble off the initial groove, even if it shows Drake chasing trends. But then he starts using that time to start creeping on girls in their early 20s, of which he's overly curious. But you know what? If we're judging that by the god-awful extended interlude, he's probably gonna treat these girls as if they're not on his level when he buys them things. I mean, obviously. You're not as classy as you think you are here either, Drake. But then it switches into a Chipmunk soul flip with a deliberate Her Loss callback. Yes. 21 Savage has his verse, and I'm sorry, this is a throwaway. It's very
Obviously
stitched together in post. Yeah, it might be better mastered than the majority of Her Loss was, but it's still bad. Unlike number 3, Virginia Beach.
Yes! Wait, he likes the song. Yes! Yes! This song is fucking awesome, bro. This song is so good. Oh my god. I hope. Oh, please like the song. Please, please. I'm pretty sure he does like the song.
Alright, here's where I give him some credits. This song is legit really damn good.
Yes.
Guitars that ramp into that ominous warp sample of Frank Ocean backing up the trap percussion. I actually really like Drake singing on the hook and
how
the frustration of the toxic give and take of this relationship manifest. Granted, this also has its fair share of corny lines when he's threatening this girl.
This song, the structure of it definitely reminds me of Search and Rescue. This song is way better than Search and Rescue. I actually do listen to Search and Rescue. Like, this is like kind of like a remake of Search and Rescue if the beat was better and like the singing was better and it doesn't have like weird Kim Kardashian parts in it. I actually like Search and Rescue. I don't know how I feel about it not being on the album. It probably wouldn't even have made a difference anyway. Like, the album would have still been fucking mid. But yeah, this song, Virginia Beach, like, that's actually, like, Virginia Beach, it's probably better than all the songs on, it's better than all the songs on Her Loss, Honestly Nevermind, and CLB, definitely better than those, better than all the songs on Dark Demo Tapes, whatever it's fucking called, Dark Lane Tapes, whatever the fuck. Better than songs on Care Package, and then that's when I start to get iffy. I don't know, that's kind of like crazy takes if I start going like before that, but this song is fucking legendary. Like, it might be the only one here, because like everybody really likes the Cole song. I don't really care for it, honestly. I don't really care for Cole in general. The last album, what was the Off Season, like, the best song for me on there was Amari, which is a horrible fucking take. But yeah, bro, this song is actually so good.
Girl's new guy, we've got the line, he gonna find out it's on site like WWW. And the exasperation at this girl's apparent selfishness.
The beat switch on this song. Well, kind of beat switch on the song is pretty good.
Drake. That being said, if there's a song where I can actually buy a little bit more dimension, almost sink into the atmosphere, it is this one. It's a really strong opener that the rest of the album cannot remotely pay off.
Yep.
One example of that.
Oh,
number
no.
2, I Don't Give a Fuck by Drake featuring Yeet.
All right, I know everyone has already said this, but like, everyone can agree that this song is just Yeet song. Like, you can definitely tell, like, they just took Yeet song and put fucking Drake on it. Mixing is shit. Everyone knows Money for Fucking Fun, that weird fucking line. It's just so weird, bro. Honestly, like, it's not, I don't listen to Yeet. Yeah, I don't listen to Yeet. I only like a couple of his songs. And I don't even really listen to those a lot. But this one, I don't know. I had higher expectations for it. And Drake only has one verse. And it's not very good. The opening of the song is fucking beautiful, though. Should have been on a better song, but whatever. I'll be giving up for I say whatever I want. Yeah, I do whatever I want. Of course he fucking plays that part.
You know, I'm fucking tired of beating around the bush. Pardon the pun, this song is dog shit. And all the more evidence
Okay. Dog shit, come on, man. Is that a joke, by the way, for all the dogs? Dog shit. Whatever, but look, bro. I know you're mad. I know we're all mad. It's not dog shit, okay? It's not good. It's not dog shit. It's okay. It's okay. It's okay.
acting to chase the rage anthems for the kids is a really bad idea. Especially if he's getting Yeet, who I've only found to be mediocre at best. Frankly, I'm being generous. Yes, I think the synths and Azimuth's vocals to open up the song, they had some potential, yeah. Especially with that trumpet. And then it slams into chiptune slop, with entirely too many hideous vocal layers, especially around the hook, that feature all sorts of ugly squawking that sounds atrocious. This doesn't even go hard. I grew up in the era of crunk that could at least throw some muscle behind the bad mixing. And here, there's no grit, there's no swagger to this, as Drake tries to sell the I stay in the O with lines that would have had Big Sean laughed out of the room a decade ago. And then there's Yeet, who has never once had anything interesting to say in all his flexing, and is trying his own god-awful Playboy Cardi impression where he can't even stay on beat. And again, all this flexing is at the expense of the audience, at you. And when it's so obviously this boring garbage, the enablement is what I find so gross. Fans friggin' demand better. So yeah, all this fucking sucks. And Drake giving Yeet a cosign to push past his overextended 15th minute. Fuck all of this.
This guy really... guys, I don't think this guy likes this song. I don't think Mark likes this song. All right. Look at me. I'm the captain. Okay. I don't think he is that bad, okay? I don't think he's that bad of an artist. A lot of mixing can be bad. He's very good at melodies, which I can appreciate. I don't personally like Yeet that much. Look, I don't think it was that bad, okay? But I do agree. I do agree. Like, just in general, not even, like, just for the song. Like, we need to, actually start, demanding better for Drake. Like, I know we've already been doing that, but, like, we need to seriously, be doing that. You know what I'm saying? Like, as a society, we need to, we need to make, 8 a.m. in Charlotte or, Virginia Beach number one. So Drake is like, okay, let me do that again and again and again. And then we get, fucking great albums finally again after 17 million years. You know what I'm saying? Do that instead of putting the low-key mid Yeet song at the top of the charts. I don't know. It's like you're fueling him doing this shit too. I think Search and Rescue gonna go number one? It might have. It probably did, honestly. Doing that type of shit, of course Drake, he's gonna get number one, obviously. But fueling he's gonna look at the chart and he's gonna be like, okay, what is the stuff that I should remake over and over and over again? I feel like this is what a lot of other artists do. Make Virginia Beach number one. Make Virginia Beach number one. ADM and Charlie even. Make that number one. I know we made Slime You Out into number one. Personally, kind of mid. But yeah, I don't even think it deserved to go number one, honestly. Now that I'm thinking about it, why is Slime You Out the single? I actually just thought about that. Why is Slime You Out the single? Listening to this album, J. Cole, I think he said, he put in his verse, on the song, a day before. I don't know if this is true. I saw that on Twitter. I'm not even sure if that's true. Imagine Drake had the J. Cole song as the single. I feel like this album would have sold way more, and the chart positions would have been way better instead of Slime Me Out. I know Slime Me Out has the big SZA feature, but I feel like the song with J. Cole would have been way bigger than Slime You Out as the first single. That might just be me though. I don't know. Maybe. Cause Slime, the discourse and the debates about this album, no one even really talks about Slime You Out. Everyone is either talking about the Drake song, First Person Shooter, How Shit Rich Baby Daddy Is, and a little bit of Virginia Beach, a little bit. And honestly, that's really the extent of what. Oh, and the 21 Savage song on how it's fucking shit. But no one really talks about Slime You Out. Who's picking Drake's singles for him? I feel like that's honestly such a blunder, not making, like, first-person shooter, like, the single. The first single to come out. Because I feel like that would have been, like, a way bigger hit than Sign Me Out. Because Sign Me Out wasn't even, like, I'm pretty sure, like, the second week Sign Me Out was, like, 13 and it debuted number one. People were fucking with it at first, but, like, after, like, a couple more listens, it just drags on for way too long. Like, all the other fucking shitty-ass Drake songs on this album, they just drag for way too long. Like, I don't know. I don't know. I'm just thinking, like, another, like, universe where first-person shooter, like, I don't even like first-person shooter that much. Like, I know, like, as a single, it would go crazy. Like, imagine, like, Drake dropped first-person shooter as a single. I feel like everyone would have gone crazy. But... yeah. I don't know what his team's fucking
doing. And finally,
doing.
Number one.
No, it's not even his team, him.
First Person Shooter by Drake featuring J. Cole.
Big as the Super Bowl, but the difference is it's just two guys playing shit that they did in the studio. Niggas usually send their verses back to me and they be terrible just like a two-year-old.
Yeah, this should be way better than it is. And if it wasn't for Drake's insecurity, it probably would have been much better. Let's not mince words. For J. Cole's first number one, he utterly washes Drake on his own song, where Drake decided to go for what sounds like a bad Kanye West impression, talking about getting bad verses from other stars and who the GOAT could possibly be. And then J. Cole goes off on his verse, including a really nice flow switch, where the braggadociousness is not super layered or special, but it is effective. And then with no warning or transition, the beat switches awkwardly for another rap verse from Drake, where I actually kind of dig the darker melody, but the bass mixing's a lot rougher, and we get lines about how he packs women's names into his phone like sardines.
Yep.
Complains more about being disrespected, and how he's so close to beating Michael Jackson's record for number one hits. Let's put aside how Drake should not give a shit about the fucking Hot 100, especially when he clearly doesn't care about the Grammys. Billboard is not some greater august institution than the Academy. But on a track where you want to accentuate that you are the best in the game right now, why even give your time to all this petty punching down? Especially when J. Cole, he still washes you on the song to the point where I just know that last verse was added in post because you didn't want J. Cole to have the last word on what's gonna become a number one hit. This is not you being in your villain arc, Drake. It's so revealingly insecure how you're only doing this because nobody's buying it on the merit of the art. And yeah, even with all that, sure, it's a good song, but it's not great. And let's keep it 100. Nobody on this track really is great. Let's be real. That concludes our week. God, it's exhausting.
Virginia Beach, best, I don't give a fuck worst, yeah.
But Drake is not getting the dishonorable mention. That's for Wild Ones by Jesse Murph and Jelly Roll. What an utterly abysmal song. Now, best of the week. You know what? Virginia Beach by Drake was really damn close. But
this is one of the only times I actually agree with him. Okay? Look. Actually, no, I agree with him on a lot of stuff, actually. But, like, this is the first time I really agree with him. Virginia Beach is very special.
That's getting the honorable mention. Because She Calls Me Back by Noah Kahan and Casey Musgraves, they kind of have that top spot. Yeah.
Never mind. I spoke too soon. I thought he was giving the top pick to Virginia Beach. You know, I haven't heard that song that he said it was the best, but it's probably not the best, honestly.
The song's got problems, but it's the best hook here. I'll say that. Next week, I can't even say it's going to be Fallout, because Bad Bunny, stay tuned for that, I guess. But until then,
we will.
I'm Mark. You're watching Billboard Breakdown, affiliated with Spectrum Pulse. I'll see you next time.
All right, Mark, look. We need to talk. No, we don't. Goodbye.